Hello friends, welcome to this investment banking tutorial from Wall Street Mojo. Today we are going to discuss about free cash flow to the firm examples. So basically we'll try and solve a couple of examples in Excel and see what are the practical applications of this. So obviously before you look at this whole video on FCFF examples, I will assume that you know what is FCFF. Basically you have an intuitive understanding of it. And in addition to that, you know the kind of formulas which are used in free cash flow to the firm. If you don't, I would highly recommend you looking at my previous videos on how to develop intuitive understanding of FCFF and also on the top three formulas of FCFF which are typically used. All right, so let's get started here. So let us now look at FCFF example in Excel. So basically I'm on the Wall Street Mojo website, and if you want, you can download this Excel example from the website directly from here by clicking on this link. Okay, so the example is basically as follows. Here we are provided with this balance sheet wherein we have the assets and the liabilities, and we are also given the income statement. So the objective of this exercise is to find the free cash flow to the firm for this year of 2008. All right. So let's get started. So here is the example in the Excel sheet. Now, let me write down the first formula that is used to calculate the free cash flow to the firm. It's basically EBIT into 1 minus tax rates. So I'll write this as 1 minus T plus your non-cash expenses. Basically, these are the depreciation and amortization plus changes in working capital minus capex. So I hope you remember this is the first formula for calculating free cash flow to the firm. Now let's look at our examples. What are the things that we require? We require the EBIT. So we have the EBIT in this example. So EBIT is nothing but 285 here. The depreciation and amortization, if you look at this example again, only depreciation is provided. So we'll assume that amortization is zero. Changes in working capital, again, it's a very interesting thing. If you remember from our earlier videos, what I specifically had mentioned that there are certain things in current assets and current liabilities which we don't include. So one of them is basically the short-term debt when we talk about the current liabilities, and the other thing that we don't include is cash when we talk about current assets. So please remember that when we're talking about working capital, you should not include cash and you shouldn't include debt. The primary reason we discussed this earlier too is that we adjust for these items at the end of the valuation exercise. So not when we are calculating the free cash flow to the firm. We assume that these numbers, let it be whatever they are, and they have to be adjusted at the end when we get the valuation of the overall firm. All right, so let's go ahead and put in the numbers. So EBIT, so EBIT here is 285, and what's the tax rate? The tax rate is 30%. So EBIT into 1 minus tax, this comes out to be 285 into 1 minus tax rate. So this is 199.5. all right. Now, depreciation and amortization, as we said earlier, amortization is equal to zero in this case. So it is just 150. Right? Changes in working capital. Changes in working capital. So working capital will now consist primarily of these two. These are the account receivables and inventory in the current assets. And in the current liabilities, we'll only consider accounts payables. Okay. So let me just copy this here. All right. So changes in working capital is nothing but whether this change has led to a cash outflow or a cash inflow. All right. I understand that many students actually get confused when they start looking at individual items and when they start tracking the changes. Say, for example, account receivables. It has increased from 45 to 90. All right. So whether this is a cash inflow or a cash outflow, I think I'll give you a shortcut to this. First, before you even think about any term here, just categorize it into assets or liabilities, okay? So account receivables, is it an asset? Yes, it is. Inventory, is it an asset? Yes, it is. Accounts payable, asset or liability? This is a liability, okay? So now, come what may, whatever is the line item here, be it account receivables, inventory, or other line item, think of if assets increase, what will happen? Obviously, if you have to buy an asset, you will have to spend cash, right? The cash outflow will happen. So if the asset size increases, cash outflow will happen. If I have to buy 10 computers, which are assets, I'll have to give amount of money to buy that computers, right? So account receivables and inventory, just close your eyes, think whether this is an asset or a liability. If it has increased, that means it is a cash outflow. So this is 45 minus 9. So essentially from cash flow point of view, this is minus 45. Now let's take an example of inventory, right? So inventory has increased from 90 to 120. So whether this is a cash inflow or outflow, has the asset size increased? Yes, it did. So it must be an outflow. So this will be 90 minus 120. So this was about assets, but let's talk about the liabilities now. So in this case, there has been no change in the assets, in the liabilities side, but let's say for argument's sake, if this was 80, so what would have been the case? What happens if liability increases? If liability increases, this, think of this as you have taken a loan from a friend or a bank, right? So if you have taken a loan, your liability increases, right? But what happens? You have now money in your pocket. So there's a cash inflow that's happening with the increase in the liability, okay? So if the accounts payable was 80 and initially it was 60, this would have been an inflow, okay, of 20. But in our example, I'll just switch it back to 60 because it was didn't change during these 2 years. So this is what is the situation. So this is the changes in working capital. The sum total of this is the overall change. Okay. So the next line item that we need to find is the capital expenditure, the capex. Okay. In order to find the capital expenditure, you can find this number in the cash flow statement. Unfortunately, we don't have the cash flow statement. We are only provided with the balance sheet and the income statement here. But obviously, there's a way out in which we can find this easily. We have been given this gross capex number, the capital expenditure. The PPE is nothing but property, plant and equipment. This is the capital expenditure. Earlier, it was 900, the total amount of assets that they had. Now it is 1200. So obviously, in order to make it to 1200, there would have been a capital expenditure or the investment in the company. So it's easy to see that the capex is nothing but the difference between the two. So capital expenditure is to an extent of 300. And please do remember, this is a cash outflow. All right. So it is an outflow. That means it has to be accompanied with a minus sign. So let me now go back and write this formula here. And let's do the sum total. EBIT into 1 minus T, that's 199.5, plus depreciation and amortization, that's 150. We have the changes in working capital, that is minus 75. And this is the capex. So obviously, this is the cash outflow. So I'm putting it with a minus sign here. So what answer do we get? It's minus 26 if we round it off. Otherwise, it's minus 25.5. So FCFF, when we use the EBIT approach, comes out to be minus 25.5 in our example. So let us now use the other two set of formulas to find the FCFF. Obviously, the answer should be same, but just for the practice purpose, let's do that right now. So the first thing that we'll do is FCFF using the net income approach. Okay, so I'll write down the formula. It's net income plus your depreciation and amortization, all right, plus interest to 1 minus tax rate, plus your changes in working capital minus capex. So the last two items are obviously the same. The only thing that changes is the first three items. Okay, so let me populate that: net income, depreciation and amortization, interest to 1 minus tax. Okay, so net income is, here we have 168 for 2008. Depreciation and amortization is 150, which we already know, and interest into 1 minus tax rate. So here, do we have the interest expense? Yes, do we have. It's 45 into bracket 1 minus tax rates. So tax rate here is 30%, that's provided in the example. So that's 31.5. Changes in working capital, this we have already calculated earlier. So this was minus 75, and capital expenditure, capex, this is 300. Okay, so let's find out this FCFF. This is net income plus depreciation and amortization plus interest into 1 minus tax plus changes in working capital minus your capex. So what do we have in the final answer? That's equal to 25.5. So it's essentially the same result that we get. So even if you start with net income, which you find it easier, you can do that. So let's move on to the third approach of free cash flow to the firm. The third formula for FCFF uses the EBITDA. CFF using EBITDA. Okay, so the formula goes like this: EBITDA into 1 minus tax rate plus your depreciation and amortization multiplied by tax rate plus your changes in working capital minus capex. So essentially, all these three terms we already know. Changes in working capital, capex, depreciation, amortization we have. The only information that we don't have is the EBITDA into 1 minus T. So I'll put this in a standard format: EBITDA into 1 minus tax rate, depreciation and amortization into tax rate, changes in working capital and capex. So let us link it from the top. So let's link this from the example above. EBITDA, we have 435 as EBITDA into 1 minus tax rate, that is 30%. Okay. Depreciation and amortization into tax rates. Depreciation amortization here is 150 into tax rate, that is 30%. Okay. Changes in working capital, we already have calculated. That's minus 75, and capital expenditure is 300. So let's do the sum total. 305 plus 45 minus 75 minus the capital expenditure. So this comes out to be 25.5. So as you see, whichever approach that you use, even the net income approach or the EBITDA approach or the EBIT approach for calculating FCFF, the answer remains the same.